be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Forth, it gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. I open my mouth and pant. I long for your commandments. Turn to me in mercy, as you always do to those who love your name. Steady my footsteps in your word, that my own iniquity have dominion over me. Rescue me from those who oppress me, and I will keep your commandments. Let your countenance shine upon your servant, and teach me your statute. My eyes shed tears, streams of tears, because people cannot keep your law. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The second reading is from Romans. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But the very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God searches the heart, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good and for those who love God, who are called according to His purpose. For those whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, in order that we might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom He predestined, He also called. And those whom He called, He also justified. And those whom He justified, He also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold His own Son, but gave Him up for all of us, will He not with Him also give us everything else? Who will bring any change against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Jesus Christ who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Please be seated. And so Jesus, after he had described these parables to his disciples, looked at them and said, have you understood this? And I think this is the first time that they all collectively said, yes. Most of the other times when he described the parables, what did they usually say? Master, tell us what you meant by that. So I'm assuming, and we know that's a dangerous word, when Jesus says, do you all understand this? We're all going to say,
yes.
All 4 of us.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Because that helps, because I'm not going to go into detail in all these parables, except maybe one. A small seed, yeast, a hidden treasure, a precious pearl, and a fish net. Well, over the last week or so, a couple of weeks, we've been reading about Jesus trying to explain the kingdom of heaven to his disciples. And as we listen to his parables, hopefully we too can understand how the kingdom of heaven is at hand and that we are part of that kingdom here and now. Well, in this series of parables, Jesus tells those committed to him about the kingdom of heaven. And with vivid color and word pictures, he shows them that the kingdom of heaven is indeed at hand or among us. He shows them that the kingdom is there for those who seek it. Now, last week's parable was on the weeds and the wheat, if you recall that. And it taught us that there is always a hostile power in the world seeking and waiting to destroy the good seed. And we should know that we are influenced by both. By both the good seed and by the hostile power. You see, the influence which helps the seed grow, or we would call the wisdom of the word, and the influence that seeks to destroy the word or growth comes into our life without our knowing it. So we must be forever on guard. that parable teaches us how hard it is to distinguish between those who are in the kingdom and those who are not. I saw a photo on Facebook, and you know, I hope you understand that you can't trust the authority or the legitimacy or the legality of anything, I don't think, on Facebook. Anyway, I don't particularly. But this one, and I've seen it, I think, a few years back, but it was very distressing to me. It shows a man standing, he's wearing a t-shirt, and he's holding a Bible in his hand, and the Bible is going into the trash can, and his t-shirt reads, "If Jesus comes back, kill him again." Well, we know that there are both good and bad in the world. But a person may appear to be good and may in fact be bad, and the other way around. And we are too quick. We are too quick to classify people and label them without knowing the facts. Anyone else guilty besides me? It teaches us not to be so quick about our judgment. You see, had the master's servants had their way, they would have tried to separate the weeds and the wheat before the harvest, and would obviously have destroyed many of the good crops in the process. And in the end, we will be judged not by a single act, nor even a stage in our life, but by our whole life. If we have made a terrible mistake in our life, you see, we can always redeem ourselves and by the grace of God, atone for it. No one who sees only part of a thing can judge the whole, and no one who knows only part of a person's life can judge the whole person. It teaches us that judgment does not come in the end, or does come in the end. It teaches us that judgment does come in the end, and judgment is not hasty, but judgment comes. It may be that, humanly speaking, in this life, the sinner seems to escape consequence, but trust me, there is a new life to come. And it teaches us that the only person with the right to judge is God. It is God alone who can discern the good and the bad, and it is God alone who sees all of a person and all of their life. Well, William Bartle, y'all know he's one of my favorite commentators, but Bartle would say, ultimately, that parable offers two things. It's a warning not to judge people at all, and it is a warning that in the end, there comes the judgment of God. Well, so much for that parable, and I want to get into today's gospel with a parable that I want to stick to, I want to get more involved in. And not all the parables, but the parable of the mustard seed. You know, I've often heard people say, "I am only one person. What can I do? What can I do to change the world?" Well, if we listen to the parable of the mustard seed, we might find an answer. You see, it was known as the poor man's fence. It provided shade and protection at no cost. It cost me to build it. Wish I'd known that before I started to build a fence. It kept predators out and it kept the children in. The mustard plant was thick, providing nests for birds who brightened the yard with music and color while keeping the insect population under control. Comfort, protection, and safety for the family. Available to the poorest of the poor, a reward far greater than the investment, tells us author Jerry Bull. Well, the mustard seed is a parable of growth. You see, the kingdom may appear to be inconsequential now, but eventually it's going to take over the field. After all, once a mustard gets into a field, it's near impossible to get it out. And I can tell you from experience that like kudzu or okra, it's hard to get out. If you've ever planted okra, you know what I mean. We planted okra 1 year, and I think it's still growing in that yard. And if you got that long, you didn't want to eat it, you used it as a weapon. It would be too hard. But that's okra. But the point is clear. The parable tells us that the kingdom of heaven begins very small, but in the end, many nations will be gathered into it. It is, in fact, a fact of history that the greatest things must always begin with the smallest beginnings. An idea which may well change civilization begins with one man. I'll give you some examples. In the British Empire, it was William Wilberforce who was responsible for freeing slaves and ending Britain's involvement in slave trade. Cecil Northcott tells us in one of his books that a group of young people from many nations were discussing how the Christian gospel might be spread. And they talked of propaganda, of literature, all the ways of disseminating the gospel in the 20th century. Then a young girl from Africa spoke up. "When we want to take Christianity to one of our villages," she said, "we don't send them books. We take a Christian family and send them to live in the village. And they make the village Christians by living there." Reformation begins almost always with one person. And what can one person do? Well, back in 1984, President Ronald Reagan told the following story to a crowd at the annual National Day of Prayer in D.C., and famed Christian speaker Tony Campola also told the story of the peace rally, and it's the story of St. Telemachus, who lived on or about 400 A.D. Considered one of the greatest stories of the Christian church, the story of Telemachus, a desert hermit who heard a call from God to go to Rome. And Rome at that time was nominally Christian, but even in the Christian Rome, the gladiatorial games went on, in which men fought and the crowds roared with the lust of blood. Well, Telemachus got cornered in a group of people as they were going into the Colosseum, and he ended up inside the Colosseum with them. He found his way to the games, and he was appalled at what he saw. And he stood up and he screamed at the top of his lungs, "In the name of Jesus, stop!" He was overgrown. The crowd was so loud, nobody heard him. So he jumped the fence, he jumped the wall, and got down into the arena. And he stood between the gladiators and again said, "In the name of Jesus, stop!" Well, at first they thought it was funny and part of the act, but the crowd started getting upset with it, and they started stoning him. Telemachus. And at one time, the prefect's command rang out, and a sword flashed in the sunlight, and Telemachus was dead. And suddenly there was a hush. Suddenly the crowd realized what had happened. A holy man lay dead. Something happened that day in Rome. The sight of the dead monk in the center of the Colosseum and the reaction of the crowd also led the emperor and his guests to silently stand, turn, and leave the Colosseum. Well, after a few minutes, the gladiators put their swords down and they too left. And all that remained in that giant Colosseum was the scrawny, lifeless body of a young monk. The memory of that man screaming to the crowd and the image of the bloodthirsty lust of the crowd had changed the hearts and minds of the Romans in that instant. And within the hour, the emperor issued an edict forbidding any future games of war within the Roman Empire. Now, the message that is retold regularly in the story of Telemachus is one that I think we need to hear. And I'm going to quote from a letter that Priscilla, the national president of the Daughters of the King, wrote. And Bishop Brewer, being the chaplain for the National Order, he wrote a prologue to her letter, and he entitled it "A Statement About Racism." And this is what our bishop says, and it's directed towards us, the clergy, but you probably don't want to hear it. He wrote, "It is urgent for Christian leaders to speak into this racially charged moment of our nation's history. Silence in this matter can be interpreted as complicity with the demonically empowered status quo that prefers one kind of human over another." And he goes on to write, "Please do not opt out. Call us all not only to repentance and faith, but also to service. Challenge us to ask the Holy Spirit to empower us for mission." And the bishop ended his remarks saying, May God help our churches become beacons of healing, serving our deeply divided communities in the name of Jesus Christ. The purpose of our faith, the purpose of all this is to form us into the very people who stand up, who look out at the world and scream out, "In the name of Jesus, stop." We need to be people who no longer let the culture and the ways of the world influence us, and instead us influence them. We need to look at all the ways of the world that lead to pain, bitterness, anger, hate, and injustice, and scream out, "In the name of Jesus, stop." When we see the oppression of our neighbors, when we see the greed of our leaders, when we see the system failing those who need the system the most, we need to stand up and say, "In the name of Jesus, stop." When our daughters are told that beauty is a measure of the skin they expose, or when our sons are told that power is shown in a clenched fist, or when the world is told that we have to care about us and me first, we need to be the ones who say, "In the name of Jesus, stop." In the very first moment of the public ministry of Jesus, Jesus declared his mission statement. He declared his very purpose of all that was to transpire over the next 3 years. And in that moment, he declared the fullness of who he was and his purpose among us. God has anointed him to bring good news to the poor. He was sent to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free. He was sent to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And in that moment, recorded in our scripture for all, our scripture for all of history, in that moment, Jesus stood up and said, "In my name, stop."
Let us stand and profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people form three. Please kneel or sit as you are able. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church, that we may all be one. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you, that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Gregory, our diocesan bishops, for our priests, deacons, and pastoral care associates, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for our president, our governor, and all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, that there may be justice and peace on the earth. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that our works may find favor in your sight. We pray for Christians and people of faith around the world who are facing persecution, that the Spirit of God may move them to protect them and strengthen them in their faith. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, that they may be delivered from their distress. Give to the departed eternal rest, especially Jim Weitzman. Let light perpetual shine upon them. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. Today, we pray for the parishes of St. Barnabas Church in DeLand, Church of the Advent in Denali. We pray for Gateway to Hope and its soup kitchen ministry in Ocala. We pray for the ministries of Haven House and Love in the name of Christ. We pray for St. Vincent's Center for Children in Haiti. We pray for Ariane and the ministry of Pelican in Afghanistan. We pray for our adopted chaplain, David Ravenscraft, serving in Kuwait. We pray for all refugees in our communities and in the world. Please join me as we pray for those in the armed forces. Almighty God, we commend to your gracious care and keeping all the men and women of our armed forces at home and abroad. Defend them day by day with your heavenly grace. Strengthen them in their trials and temptations. Give them courage to face the perils which beset them, and grant them a sense of your abiding presence wherever they may be, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, we have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you.
So, it's good to see you all tonight. The Lord's provided a good evening for us. I don't have much in mind of announcements other than I saw on Facebook that Father John and Tish are enjoying their time in Ashrams. I'm happy for them. I hope they have a grand time. I want to put in a little blip for our Thursday service. Now, you guys are coming Saturday night, and that's wonderful, but maybe you have neighbors. Maybe you have friends who still don't want to come into the church but want to receive communion and want to be part of the service. Thursday at 10 o'clock, the Memorial Garden. Every Thursday, I'm doing a Eucharist service. And invite your friends. They don't have to be Episcopalians. Just say, hey, if you're looking for a place to gather on Thursday, you want to praise the Lord, have a little communion, listen to some ragged guitar music, come along. We have any birthdays or anniversaries tonight? I know we got an anniversary. Andre and his beautiful wife is celebrating 37, is that right? I know it's 37 because I think Phyllis and I are do our 37th this year. So anyway, let's say amateur prayer for Andre and Joe. O God, you have so consecrated the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send therefore your blessings upon these your servants, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now, ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings and commend his courts of praise. These are the gifts of God to the people of God. Take them, feed them in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. All things come of thee, O Lord. We continue with Eucharistic prayer C. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God of power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise. Glory to you forever and ever. At your command, all things came to be, the vast expanse of interstellar. prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law. In the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace. By his blood, he reconciled us, and by his wounds, we are healed. And therefore, we praise you, joining the heavenly chorus with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory and your unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so, Father, you may kneel, sit as you're able. And so, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by water and the Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming. Lord God of our fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Risen Lord, be known to us in the remaining of our life. Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great High Priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit your church gives honor and glory and worship from generation to generation. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Hallelujah, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Myself to you and embrace you with all the affection of my soul. Let let nothing ever separate you from me. May I live and die in your arms. Amen. Thank you. Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you now, in the name of you always.